somebody who also had, it was almost a member of the extended Bush family, is our own Dana Perino. Got to know you when you were press secretary for George W. Bush, mm-hmm. and you got to know George H.W. Bush very well as well.
Like, probably the biggest honor of my life, to be able to have said that I knew him. My husband last night said, well, like, we actually knew him. And you've really felt like he did know you. The first thing he always did was ask questions about you. How's Peter? How's the dog? He knew about...
yes,
even everyone knows about Jasper, Dan.
Jasper. And it was Henry before that. And Ed, you know, when you were in the White House briefing room, you know how the reporters can go up that little ramp up to the press secretary's office. And there was one time I was on the phone, and of course you're always busy, busy, busy. And I hear all this commotion outside, and my staff is laughing. I'm like, who, what knucklehead is out there? And I look out, and there's 41. And I got up, and I said, sir, I'm so sorry. I was just on the phone with Karl Rove. And he said, oh, I love a name dropper.
Give you a little bit.
He made you feel very special. But the reason he had come by that day is he said, I just wanted to take a moment and to thank you for all you do for my son.
Oh, wow.
And it wasn't about... the relationship's so interesting. Only the second time in our history, and probably maybe never happen again, where you have a father and a son both serve as president. But one of the things I remember is that 41 said it was much harder to witness the criticism of his son than it was to have been criticized himself. And vice versa for them. Their relationship's very close, and I do feel for George W. Bush and all of the family, because even though it wasn't unexpected that 41 would pass away, and especially because his health had been in deterioration, he wanted that one more summer in Maine, in Kennebunkport, up at his home, and I got to see him last June, and he was holding my hand, and I kept trying to be respectful and let him be. And he just wanted me to keep telling stories, and he'd yank my hand back down, like, don't go. So we got to be there. And when we left, I told Peter, I think that's the last time we'll ever see him. Mm. Yeah, it's really heartbreaking.
Yeah.
What, if you remember, what were one of the stories that you shared with him that he loved?
Well, 41 loved to gossip about the media.
No.
He never said fake news, but, you know, he had his run-ins with the media. But he was interested in people's lives and what was happening. And also, just think of those 94 years, the kinds of technological innovations that he saw. One of my favorite experiences was when we went to the Olympics in Beijing in 2008. 41 was the co-founder or the co-chair of the United States delegation, and his staff wasn't going with him, and so they asked me, Dana, would you mind sitting in on an interview he's going to do with Mike Abramowitz, who was at the time with the Washington Post? I thought, sure. Well, I didn't even feel like I was staffing it. I sat there enthralled listening to these stories, and especially about, I'll tell you this one, you know, it's morning television, but I can tell this. So they're talking about how during Watergate, the Republican Party is in a shambles, and he keeps getting calls from donors. This is when he's the chairman of the RNC. Calls from donors like, you got to get this Watergate thing off the front page. You got to put this in a box. You got to move on. Change the story. And 41 told us that he said, you know, this story is like making love to a gorilla. It's not going to stop unless the gorilla wants it to. And he had this wit, but an ability to, like, I'm like, he's exactly right. Like, he had vision. He always accepted the call. You know, he was at the RNC. He was at the CIA. He was at the United Nations. He was vice president. He was president. And I would argue set the best example for how to conduct yourself in the post-presidency. Mm. There for the presidents if they need him, but staying out of the limelight as well.
And it's that public service angle that I think is standing out so much this morning. We live in a society now where public service is viewed as a temporary job to lead to another job in the private sector where one gets paid a boatload of money. Mm. Granted, H.W. Bush didn't need the money. He was a millionaire early on in his life. But you mentioned all those different jobs that he took.
Well, let's go back, though, because, yes, he would say that, of course, he grew up in a privileged. But he didn't accept the handout. When he got back from the war, he finished college. He was a college baseball player. He immediately, they get married, and George W. Bush is born. And Barbara Bush would do the box scores, and holding the baby. And then 41 had an opportunity to come here to Wall Street. And he says, no, I'm going to make my way. And they leave, they get in a car, and they drive to Midland, Texas, and Odessa, Texas, and then they go to California. They had nothing. In fact, I was just telling Anita McBride downstairs, at one point he's painting barrels. That was his job, painting barrels. And this guy comes up to him and he says, "You a college man?" He says, "Yes, sir." He says, "Where'd you go?" He says, "Yale, sir." The guy says, "Huh. Never heard of it."
Never heard of Yale.
So he was born into privilege. He would say that. But he was a self-made
but
man.
But he also understood the common person as well. And a quick story, and I want to bring in Pete Hegseth after that, which is that you and I both remember July 2007, covering the White House, and George H.W. Bush, who rarely intervened, said, "You need to repair this relationship," he said to George W. Bush, "with Vladimir Putin," who was on the stage then. And so they had a mini summit in Kennebunkport. And what I remember is two things. One, Steve Holland from Reuters, who's still covering the White House, you know him well, he was telling us all stories about how when 41 was president, he would invite the reporters over, a much simpler time, for barbecues. And they'd go to Walker's Point thinking there would be this super rich place and all that. And it was beautiful. Mm-hmm. But H.W. would be there in shorts and like a T-shirt with a can of beer flipping the burgers. Steve, you want a cheeseburger? You want this? He was very down to earth. And then we were getting ready for a news conference, Vladimir Putin and George W. Bush, with the Atlantic Ocean behind them. They had gone fishing to try to get to know each other a little better and all that. And all of a sudden, a bunch of us reporters noticed coming out of almost the bushes, literally, was H.W. Bush, the former president, and Barbara Bush, the former first lady. And they were standing. And here's the photo I snapped. I found this. I forgot I had taken it. And we started engaging them and saying, "Hey, Mr. President, what do you think about your son?" And he did not want to make a headline, didn't want to step on his son. And I remember him saying something to the effect of, "Just here to support my boy." And I thought, he's a dad.
Yeah. And I think one of the things I learned in Decision Points is the book 43 wrote after he left office. And in that first chapter, he talks about his parents and that because they gave him unconditional love, he was able to take risks because he knew if he failed, he was still going to be loved. Yeah. And I think the closeness of the family is something that I think all of us could aspire to. And also, you know, if you're a young couple, look to the example of Barbara Bush and George H.W. Bush. There was a lot of pressure on Barbara Bush. Remember, it was, oh, she should dye her hair. She should wear different clothes. She should do all of these things. And he said, "I love you as you are." And he did not want her to change. They had such a beautiful relationship, and now they're reunited.